when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need.
We went to church every Sunday morning, Sunday nights and weekdays too. We learned about Jesus and how to make it through. Well, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He traded beauty for those ashes and he set my spirit free. We planted fields of crop by faith. God would help them to grow. Mercy left in his hand when my dad began to sow. The yonder tractor kept us working as we did our very best. With two cylinders that made that noise, but that old putt-putt made us rest. Oh, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. Traded beauty for those ashes, and he set my spirit free. When the last leaf was sown, found the purest gold. We bought the groceries and we paid our bills. We went to church to give thanks for God who gave us strength to work another year in the field. Oh, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He traded beauty for those ashes and he set my spirit free.
See if I can. One night while upon life's raging seas, looked as if I would suffer defeat. Darkness of night closed off the light, my heart sank with fear. I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this old boy's mine. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Looking for me, he came looking for me, he came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near, rescued my soul and calmed my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Looking for me. Satan had already picked out my grave. His plan had moved forward to put me away. I drifted so far, would anyone care that I should be lost? I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this one is mine. I'm safe from all harm, so he walked through the storm. Looking for me, he came looking for me, he came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near to rescue my soul and calm my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. I've always been a man of few words. I don't talk good, I mumble bad, but still my prayers are heard. And they availeth much, so Scripture says, as they travel to the throne. Sometimes silence falls and fills the air when I'm all alone. And when I don't know how to pray, I just praise. When life gets hard, the words won't come. I don't know what to say. So I'll just bow my head and raise my hands, Lord, hallowed be thy name. And when I don't know how to praise, I just praise. And my praying time is filled with requests. I offer little, but want so much. Lord, you know what is best. But in the middle of the quiet times, in the storms of life, intercession occurs for me. And so thy kingdom come, thy will be done, from here to eternity. When I don't know how to pray, I just praise. Life gets hard, the words won't come. I don't know what to say. So I'll just bow my head and raise my hands, Lord, hallowed be thy name. When I don't know how to pray, I just praise. And I know the sun stood still when Joshua prayed. And by Elijah's prayer, the fire fell down and your greatness was displayed. I don't have those words to pray right now. You know my heart, you know my mind. I trust you to work it out. I know my thoughts ain't yours and your ways ain't mine. I prove that every day. I'll just do my best to praise your name when I don't know how to pray.
Well, I'm kind of home, sick for a country to which I've never. Time won't matter anymore. Beulah land, I'm longing for you. And someday on thee I'll stand. Thank you. where my faith will inside. There's just a few more days to labor, then I'll take my heavenly flight. Beulah land, I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand. There my home.
Well, it's good to see everybody tonight. Good to be back in the Lord's house around his people. So let's open up in a word of prayer. Jared, will you open us up tonight, brother? Amen. Thank you. Okay, so let's talk about the calendar just for a few minutes. So church conference will be right after services tonight. Ladies quilting on the 14th at 10 a.m. June the 20th is Father's Day. There'll be no evening services next week for Father's Day. 4th of July is Independence Day. And on the 5th, the office here at the church will be closed. So that's the calendar. And happy birthday to Carrie Johns, belated, Griffin White, Amelia Cruz, Evan Payne, and happy anniversary to Larry and Allison Johns, and Jarrett and Camille. So congratulations to all those folks. We didn't miss nobody, did we? So we got all the birthdays and all the any other calendar events that I might have overlooked needs to be mentioned. Okay. So let's turn to our prayer list. Is anybody needs to be added to the prayer list tonight?
Just make sure Miss Allison's on there.
Okay. I want to make sure that Aunt Allison's on the prayer list. Ava Harris. Okay. Wanda Cleland. Okay. Dan Maddox to the Breve. Okay, there. Kane and Grace Lee. Lee is an L-E.
Yes,
Kane and Grace Lee, okay. Okay, Ronnie Spradley. Okay, you said McKenna? Jeff?
Chance Lee.
Chance? Okay, so Chance Lee. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, any unspoken? Okay. All right. All at peace. Last, Brother Lamar, will you remember these, brother? Amen. Thank you.
We're going to have one congregational hymn tonight, and we got Buck and Roy and Grandpa Jones and Minnie Pearl's going to be singing the rest of them for us over there. So, and whoever else would like to. This will also be our offertory hymn, so you guys come on right after this one. 384, Let's Stand the Bond of Love.
Thank you.
About a year ago. Had to get a shot in my back. And I got up there, and the girl asked me, said, what's your birth date? I said, 6/10/1954. I heard this voice in the back, and the girl come out and said, that's my birthday. I said, you don't look like you're 66 years old. Are you 66, 67? 6/10 what? What's your birthday, 6/10? Me and you got to see, we got something in common there, buddy. 16, we both us June the 10th. That's right. We both us June the 10th. All right. I need to back that. Y'all ready? Be singing one while he comes. I bet you know, Brother Jamie got all over my toes. I'm sorry, but a couple of weeks ago I was supposed to sing a song, wasn't I, Christy? I told Christy, I said I was disobedient this morning. Brother Jamie preached on Jesus walking on the water and Peter going to him, and I had it in my heart to sing this song, and I didn't sing it. Brother David asked me to sing something else, and I sang something else. So I'm going to do this one tonight. I can't take a broken heart and make it over again. But I know a man who can. I can't take a soul that's sincere and wash it whiter than snow, but I know a man who can. Some call him Savior, the Redeemer of men, but I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. When you think
no one can help you, and your life is out of hand. Well, I know a man who can. Well, I can't walk upon the water or calm the raging seas, but I know a man who can. I can't open blinded eyes or make the lame to walk again, but I know a man who can. Well, some call Savior, the Redeemer of men, but I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. When you think no one can help you and your life is out of hand, I know a man.
Riverside, cares all passed away, and with never a pain to bear, what a happy day. Somebody loves me, answers my prayer. I love somebody, I know he cares. Somebody tells me not to be kind, that somebody is Jesus, and I know he's mine. Somebody loves me, answers my prayer. I love somebody, I know he cares. Somebody tells me not to repine, that somebody is Jesus and I know he's mine.
I know you was out here singing too. You should have been up here.
They didn't sing the last song that they normally sing. And how's it go? We love the time we spend with you. Minnie, you let us down on that one, girl. I'm going to ask somebody to do something. If they're not prepared tonight, they won't. But I just come to me. Anna asked me here a while back, you want to do it tonight or you want to do it? She asked me, when could she come share her testimony? And I said, whenever. She works a lot on Sunday mornings, but she's here tonight, so I'm going to ask her to come. You just come stand right here. Okay. They'll turn. You can turn mine off and turn hers on.
Okay.
That's my girl right there.
Well, yeah, I wasn't quite prepared, but it's okay. I've been thinking about it for quite a while now. I've been coming here for several years, and I'm originally from Hoboken, and so I'm like a Hickox transplant. And some of you guys I've known, but some of you I haven't known until I started coming here. And like I said, I've been coming to church my whole life, and I turned 26 this week, and I just hear lately Brother Jamie's preaching and just different things. I realize I've never really shared my testimony. Sorry, I might say a lot. Cause I wasn't quite prepared, but I promise it'll get better. What it is I don't have probably like a big testimony where it's like this huge change in my life. I've been very blessed. I'm a product of where you train up a child in the way they should go, and they will not depart from it. So I've been very blessed. My family, my parents didn't go to church growing up. My immediate family, my mama, I know I've shared with you guys that she had recently gave her life to the Lord, and she'd made some changes. My daddy, he's still a work in progress, so y'all pray for him. But I know God does amazing things. He has done so many good things in my life. I've just been so blessed, and I don't know why I'm crying. Well, I do know why I'm crying, but I'm gonna try not to, because if I do, then my words won't work. So, growing up, I did have, like I said, wonderful family members. My mom and daddy didn't go to church, but my aunt, she comes with me sometimes. She always took me to church, and she took my brother. And I will say this, like, this week we just had VBS, and VBS is very special to me. I got saved when I was 8 years old, and it was like the second or third night of VBS. I used to go to Satilla Baptist, and even from being a young child, I remember just all that stuff. It matters so much. People don't really realize what you're doing, or sometimes you think you do things in vain, or not vain, but it doesn't mean that much. I know I helped Corey Wainwright do class this week in VBS for fifth grade, and he done amazing. He done a really good job with the kids, and he was just saying, like, oh, I hope, you know, they're getting a message out of the lessons I'm telling them and this and that. And I know personally, when you're 8, 9, 10, 11, stuff sinks in more than you realize. So it's when you're laboring and doing God's work, you just plant them seeds. And I know we all know this, God does the rest. So, but anyhow, like I said, I got saved for VBS, and so it's always been a really special thing to me. The ABCs, I still remember that to this day. That's what they done when I was a kid, and that's what it was easy for me to understand back then, and I know these kids these days, they understand it. So, my testimony is, now that I'm grown, I feel like I've been a kid that's been really invested into. You know, you grow up, you're going to church, and I know a lot of you could probably relate, like you're raising your kids, you're taking them to church, you're teaching them the Word of God and this and that, and they're using this book for like and everything they learned in church for to have a foundation, literally, to build their life upon. And that is what it has been for me. So the older, I used to read the Bible, like you're growing up and you come to church, and when you're a kid, you quite don't get it. I mean, you sing the songs and you hear the preacher preach, and I know I've always believed Jesus died on the cross for my sins and everything that you learn, but then when you become an adult, something changes. It's just like when your parents raise you, you don't realize all they've done for you until you start doing it yourself, and you're like, oh, wow, like, it just means so much more, I guess. Or you just, your eyes are open more, I guess. Like I said, I've been to church my whole life. I know this, read this book back and forth, and every day it's like my relationship with God, it just means so much more. I know I have several things just when you encounter life and you're like, oh my goodness, that's why God put this in the Bible, or this is why this is there. It just becomes more real to you as you experience life. And I know I've been thankful. I got saved when I was 8. I'm probably saying this all in the wrong order, but I probably haven't always stayed on the complete right path. It is bad because sometimes you know to do good, and we don't always do perfectly right. We're human. We make mistakes. But I know that, thankfully, I've always known the right way and where to go and who to ask to pray for and where to seek guidance. So I've just been so blessed. And then when I turned 21, it was in 2017, it was revival here. Brother Jamie didn't preach. I can't remember who was preaching, but I had rededicated my life then because I felt like, even though I got saved at 8 years old, and I believed then, and I've always believed, and I've known, I didn't quite grasp exactly what it meant to follow Jesus. You know, like, you come to church, you pray, you sing, you do everything, and what Brother Jamie preaches, you do a wonderful job. Thank you. You do absolutely wonderful job of explaining the word and telling us the right things. Even I know it can't be easy getting up here and sharing different, or I know it's not now. It is more difficult than I realize. But anyhow, I'm just so thankful for all the people, my family, and the church. I've had a bunch of good church Sunday school teachers and all the great examples of godly people in my life, and I've always had the Bible and God. So I've been very blessed. It's, like I said, my testimony is probably not like I haven't done drugs and just totally made a huge life change, but God has still done amazing things in my life, and I pray He continues. It's like the more you grow in Christ, and you just, like I said, since I've become an adult, when I was a teenager and I was coming to church, it was more so for me. Like when you're bringing your kids to church and you're raising them, you're teaching them to pray, you're teaching them to read the Bible, you're teaching them this and that, and you're building the foundations of their life. But then you get to a point where you're an adult and you know all these things that Jesus has done, and you know the Bible, and you look out and into the world, and you see people suffering and going through different things, and it's an amazing thing to be able to like to share that with them, you know, to share what you've learned your whole life and share Christ with them. And I think that's the biggest part of being a Christian, is showing the love of Christ that I have in my heart, and how I've been blessed and how it's helped me throughout my whole life. And that's the biggest part, is just helping other people. I know I've been helped and encouraged here. This is a wonderful church to go to, just wonderful people. I've been shown so much love, God's love. And that's what church to me is all about, is helping other people and truly leading people to Christ and showing them the love of Christ. And God's still working on me. I'm not perfect by no means, but I know the way. I'm thankful for all he's done. And I just realized, you know, I'm 26 and I've never really openly shared any my testimony. I reckon that's what it is. Like I said, it's not like I had this just huge change in my life. I've been thankful and blessed that I've always been raised up in church, so I've always known the right way. Sometimes that I used to think, oh man, I wish I didn't. I don't feel so bad about, you know, some of the stuff I've done wrong. But I mean, we all make mistakes, and I know what it means to repent and ask for forgiveness and get back on track, you know. And that's why I've always been able to come to church, and I do, because what Jesus did for me, it's really real to me. And I think I've, you know, you kind of forget, like you hear it so much, like Jesus died on the cross for our sins, but, and you hear it all the time, and we sing these songs, but when you really live in his promises and what the word says, and I mean, it's really amazing. I'm so thankful for every blessing that has been bestowed upon me. I don't deserve any of them. I've seen people struggle and, you know, just go through different things, and they weren't shown the right way, or they don't know how to pray, or they just turn to other things. So I've always known the way to go, and try to share that with others. I could do a way better job, but I just, like I said, God's still working on me, and I'm so thankful for everything he's done. I probably left out some stuff I wanted to share, but I feel like I've pretty much covered it all. I love all you guys. I'm sorry, I've been up here crying. I can't speak right when I get emotional, and but thank you for all the love that Hickox Baptist has shown me. I've enjoyed coming here, and I love each and every one of you. So I'm glad I got to share a little bit about myself with y'all. Thank you.
I hadn't lawfully adopted her, but spiritually I have. And I told her feller point blank the other day, that was a good girl right there. And if she messes something up there, you're going to have to answer to me. Or whoever messes with her, she's a sweetheart. I don't know, I felt led. She come to me the other day and just, she said what she said, and I said, I can make arrangements for that young lady. She's special to me. She's got a good job and a good future ahead of her right now, and God has blessed you. And we're all still a work in progress. Where none of us has arrived at that. Have your Bibles again tonight, just for a little bit. I want to go into God's Word. She's done enough to bless my heart. Oh, by the way, Anna, if you think of them other things you did, I'm sure they would love to hear the rest of that. Anyway. Okay. No, that'd be all right. Crying's good. When you get where you can't cry, you're hurting. You're hurting. You're hurting. You're hurting. Romans chapter 8, did I tell you that? Romans chapter 8. At least you had your Bible in your lap ready to go. Romans chapter 8. Again, if you would stand with me, I'm going to read some verses and 28 down for just a little bit, and then I have a few thoughts for tonight. It says this, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestine to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestine, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, then he also glorified. What shall we say then? What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?" And in the next verse it says this, "He spared not his own Son." Father, tonight, God, as we look into your word, and God, we thank you for our sister that's, Lord, she stood in the gap for you. God, we all have something to say because we're all been blessed. God, help us always not to be forgetful and give and turn thanks back to the one that gets us to us. have blessed us so much. But God, as we stand tonight, I pray you'd open up the word, Lord, that we may understand and draw strength from it, Lord, and your will be done. And all God's people said, amen. Looking at that next verse, we went over a lot of things. One word I want to go back to verse 28. I pulled one word out this morning. I'm going to pull one out for just a little bit here. It kept ringing in my ear today. And it says, who are the called according to his purpose? What's the purpose of God? You know, we have a purpose in life. You go to work, you do that, and you have a purpose. You have a purpose to do things like that. The purpose that God created mankind for was to worship him. That's our purpose. And not only that, our purpose is mentioned here. We should just be justified through Christ, but we should glorify King Jesus. That is the purpose. And we have a purpose in this life. We all won't go down the same path. Now, we'll all go down the same path for salvation, but we won't all go down the same paths as far as our career with God, our life on earth with God. So we have a purpose. But his purpose for you and I is for to be the be his glory and to be the one that leads others to Christ and to be a workman that need not be ashamed. And I pray that we can all be that way. But when we get down to verse 32, he said this, as Paul was writing here and he had asked that question, if God be for us, who could be against us? He says, he that spared not his son, talking about God himself, spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us. And how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? He give us all things. I look at people that talks about rights. You know, let me tell you, we don't have no rights. I used to tell my kids they'd make me so mad at this house, at my house and this stuff like trying to raise them up and all that. And I'd finally get to the point where I'd say, you do not have rights unless I give them to you. This is my house. I provided it for you. There's food on your table. There's clothes on your back. Whether it might not be the ones you want, but they fit and they cover up and they do what they're supposed to do. You don't have no rights until you reach what Anna has told us where she is. Then you have rights. You have the right to make that decision to do this or that or the other, or pay the consequences for the wrong ones or reap the benefits of the good ones. You don't have no rights. But who has the right to do what he did for us? As he says that if God be for us, who could be against us? And then when he talks about that, he said that he spared not his own son. God has the right. No one, no thing has ever done what he's done. That his son came on earth and took up the flesh of man and died on the cross for us. He has the right to do exactly what? The right to do what? Well, the right to justify us. The right to condemn us. The right to do whatever he will with us. But an amazing thing about God and the plan of salvation is he elected to let people come of their own free will to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I wonder in my mind sometimes, Lord, did you make it too easy? Did you make it too easy that we must be saved? You sent your son. He died for us. He paid for our sin debt. He done all that. And all we have to do is believe. All we have to do is believe. I wonder if some people could think that they may could work their way into there, if that was some part of it, would that work? And then I got to thinking about a thing. I said, no, because the Bible tells us clearly, it's not that we should boast at all. There's nothing I can do to make myself worthy to inherit eternal life. Nothing. Only Jesus did that. And if it were, then it would be something that wouldn't be as worth as much as it is now. It's paid for by Christ. It's paid for by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And there's nothing that we can say or add to put our 2 cents in that. He did it all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin left a crimson stain, and he made me white as snow. That's all it was. He says, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? That's the ones that believe in him. Who can do anything like that? Let me tell you, nothing can touch you unless it passes through his hand. Don't, and nothing's going to take him by surprise. If you get sick, if you run into troubles, you did this or that, it don't take him by surprise. I think sometimes he just reminds us that we're not as strong as we think we are. We're not as invulnerable as we think we are. We can be conquered. We can be whipped down. But the scripture we're going to get to and we'll close tonight is coming up pretty quick. And that would be in verse 37. He says, nay, in all things, we are more than conquerors. Not on our own, but through him. It says through him that loved us. We only got what we got from him because of love. He has unconditional love. We mentioned that this morning. And how could you love someone so much? You know, we have trouble in this life, and a love's a big part of it. When you feel like you've loved more than someone else and they're not returning that, then you got trouble in the camp. And then when someone hadn't been as faithful to loving you as you tried to love, you got faithful in the camp. That'll never be the problem you'll have with Jesus Christ. You will never love him like he loved you. But if you try throughout eternity, if you try till you die, then that's the goal you need to be doing, trying to love him back for what he's done for you. Because we will never be able to pay him for what he done. That the Bible says that no greater love than this, than a man would lay down his life for his friend. And we are considered the friends of God. We are the children of God. And in all things, here he says, who is he that condemneth? Now notice what Paul answers right in that when he asks this question. It says, it is Christ that died. Yea, he thought about it. It's kind of unique how this is put in there. He says, who can condemn us? And he says, it is Christ that died. And then for a moment there, he says, you know what? He's not just dead. He says, yea, rather, that he is risen again. He died for us, but he rose again. How can that work? Well, we ain't serving a dead God. We serve a Savior that died and had the power within himself to raise from that dead and become new life and be back on the throne by his Father where he should be and reigns forever and ever. The one that saved us is still alive. You know, we had memorial service the other day. It was a time that we reflect for those who died for the freedom that we have on this earth. Well, Jesus Christ is totally different. He died so that we could be set free. He did all that, but yet he lives again. And he never lost authority. He never lost power. He never lost kingship. All he done was done the next step that the Heavenly Father had a plan for him. And it was the salvation plan. Somewhere between them 400 silent years, between the last book of the Old Testament and the first book of the New Testament, we don't really know what happened in that span. But I'll tell you what, then when he made up his mind to send his son Christ to die for us, man, did it make a, it was it, it, the new terminology, that was a game changer. It wasn't just a game changer because this life we live is a game. It was a life changer. It was the eternal changer. We could trust in Jesus Christ. No one up to that point had ever done. We've had Moses. We had Abraham. We had many in the Old Testament that never could live up. We even had Adam, the first man, that never could live up to the standard. So God says, I'll tell you what, I'll send part of me, and that would be Christ. I'll send him. You know what? And it didn't just end there. He said, I'll leave something with you. He says, I'll still leave you part of the kingdom of God, one of the hard things that the Jehovah's Witnesses have a problem with is the Trinity. How that you can have three things and they all be the same one. How it all goes through the same thing. Well, I can tell you, when you make a pie and you eat it, it's still pie. Don't matter if you got a little piece or a big piece, it's still pie. And that's the way it is with the kingdom of heaven. He said, if you believe in me, you believe in the Father. No man comes to the Father except by me. He says, when I leave you, I'll leave you with a comforter, and he will be with you always. And that's how we speak. That's how we can enter into the holies of holies. Can you imagine in the old days when the priest there, they tie a rope on him in case he did not live up to snuff and he went into the holies of holies, and because of the sin in his life wasn't caught up, that it would kill him dead? Jesus Christ don't have to have a rope. He is high. He is royalty. He is sinless. And he is at the point. The Bible says he is our intercessor. He is our propitiation. He has the right to just stand there. He don't make an appointment with the Father. He and the Father have the same mind and the same love and the same dedication to the ones that love him. He said, who is he that condemned? He said, it is Christ, yea, that is risen, who even in the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? No, trouble won't. Shall distress? No, it won't. Or persecution? No, it won't. Or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword. As it is written, he says, for they spake, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. There's something that we talk about sometimes when a child or someone working on in the workforce goes far beyond that. We call them overachievers. Overachievers. You know, really, in the whole life that we live, the only way to be an overachiever is to be born again. You know, you can obtain and achieve things in this life just in the flesh alone. And there's a lot of people that have done it without being born again. I'm not going to say without the aid and the help of God, because all good and perfect gifts come from above. All the reason why you have what you have is not on your own merit. You know, I made the best taters I ever made in my life this year, some of the biggest ones I ever made in my life this year. I said, you notice how I said that I made. I didn't make nothing. I put them eyes in the ground and covered up with dirt, and God made taters. God made taters. And I appreciate it, because I like tater salad, French fries, tater this, tater that, tater head. I just love taters. And it's amazing that you can put that one eye in there and come back later on and there's a wad of taters that big in the ground. Who can do that? Can science do that? No, heavens no. You can't take a dried up bean and throw it in the ground, and because of the warm sunshine and the water that comes down from heaven and it causes it to germinate. What is that? Give life. That's what happened to me May 17th, 1972 in the Spirit of God. My soul was germinated by the Spirit of God when I asked him to come into my heart and save me. Who can separate us? Not only that, let me ask you, what can separate you from the love of God? I'll tell you, there's one thing that can. There's one thing that can. You can separate yourself from the love of God. But nothing can separate you between you and God. Nothing can take it. Nothing can steal it away. The only thing is your walk with Christ, the worst thing could ever happen is you fall out of love with him and leave. He's not going to fall out of love with you. He's going to love you till the very end. But there's nothing that can drive you, force you away, unless you allow it to be. I ain't saying you can lose your salvation. The Bible says even at that, someone that just turns their back on God and walks away and never looks back ever again. You know what the Bible says? He says, I'll turn that person over to a reprobate mind. Not only that, he says, and I may kill the body that the soul may live, that he may not bring my son and his blood to an open shame. You say, preacher, you believe that? Well, I have to, because it's the word of God. And you know what? I'm fearful of that. I think of some of the stuff that I do, you know, knowingly and unknowingly, that I mess around and I do, that I get in trouble with God. And I don't know how people live that say they're Christians and walk away and you see and hear all the stuff that they're doing and you go, why? Why me, Lord? What did I ever do? What did I ever do? And then I got to realize, you know, a sin is a sin. He loved me. But I can tell you, the reason we can be more than a conqueror, we can be overachievers, it's not on our merit. But I'll tell you what does get you stronger. The closer you want to get to the Lord, the closer he'll allow you to get. And I'll tell you, you can be a high achiever, an overachiever in the Lord, because there is awards waiting for you. There is rewards waiting for you in heaven. Some's going to get bare by the way, is what the little pig said, by the hair of his chinny chin chin. Some people's going to get in there by that, and some people's going to have a pretty nice furnished home in glory. Hey, I hope mine, because of neglect and lack of desire, I hope I don't wind up with just a little bitty cabin in the corner of glory land. I want a room. The Bible tells me that my father went there to build a house, and in that house were many mansions, and if it was not so, he wouldn't have lied to us and told us if that weren't so. So if I'm going to live in a mansion, I'm not looking for a cabin in the corner of glory land. And I like that old song, and it sounds good. But I'll tell you what, if you ask the people that's already in hell or the ones that have to go to hell, they'd be satisfied with just a little cabin in the corner of glory land. They would be there just fine just to get out of there with that. But the thing about it is, it's eternal. There's no change. I really think in the back of some people's mind, I can't for the life of me think that maybe God will feel sorry because they may have heard where God regretted it. They done something, and all that means he just done an about face and started treating people different because they started treating him different. You want God to love you and bless you more, you start loving him and blessing him more, and it'll come that way. He'll pour out a blessing. He says he'll open up the windows of glory and pour out more than your cup and hole, and it will run over into the saucer. Yeah, I've told you about that, didn't you? That's how I learned to drink coffee as a little baby. A little child. I couldn't hold that hot cup. My granny, she always had a cup and a saucer, and that's how she poured your coffee. Mine was more like a bowl than a saucer. She'd pour a little bit of that hot coffee in there, and she'd blow that thing, and I could pick that saucer up, and I could out of that thing. You know what? Eventually, I become where I was man enough to hold my own cup, and I didn't have to drink out of the saucer anymore. But I sure didn't waste anything when I poured it in there because it went directly into my mouth. You know, I watched my grandkids, and I was trying to feed Tadpole a dreamsicle. Y'all know what a dreamsicle is, don't you? That's that orange sherbet with the vanilla ice cream in it. It ain't good. Don't get none of them. And he was having a time trying to figure out how to hold that stick, and he was holding it. His fingers got cold. So his Mimi scraped it off in a bowl, and he can do it, but it's hard for him to do that and watch TV at the same time. And he was kind of struggling with it, so Papa reached over there, and we became pals. I figured out about how much he wanted at the time. And as he would watch TV, Papa would dip some in there, and I'd get it. If I touched his lip and it wasn't open, I'd touch his lip, and that thing would go, in ice cream go, close his mouth, and there it was. I mean, it was a perfect life, but it was amazing. I'm teaching him to do something that he can do a little bit of now, but the more he practices, the better he'll get. Look how good I got. I don't miss. I don't spill hardly ever. If it is, it's because my spoon or fork is overloaded. And that's the way you walk with Christ. It's going to be a struggle. It's going to be a learning curve to start with. But once you learn, and the more you get better at it, not only that, you be like what Papa done today. I didn't eat any of his ice cream. But I was feeding him. And as a Christian, when you get pretty good with that spiritual spoon, as Anna was saying, you're able then to feed somebody else. And you might have to do what my granny done. You may have to start them out in a saucer. Or you may have to start them out in a smaller spoon. And the quantity might not be what you're there for. You might be there for the quality. And it might take but just a few minutes of your love and your time to express the amount of love that Jesus has for them. But I can tell you, based on the word and what we heard today, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And in that, we're more than conquerors. How can you be more than a conqueror? If you conquered it, you must have been the very best that it was to defeat and to overcome that. He says, if you think that's something, he says, with him, you're more than that. I pray today you have him on your side. I'm like Jerry Clower. We was talking one time in this thing about this big old football player that was an All-American, all like that. He said he was just glad to know that he was on his side. I'm glad to know that I'm on Jesus' side. He's got my back. He's got my back. I'm on his team. He called me, and I didn't just choose him. He chose me from the foundations of the earth. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus tonight, we thank you. God, that you loved us. And in the scripture says you spared not your son. Lord, you gave him to us. And he came. And he died. But even yet at that, rose again to live forevermore. Never separated his love from us. God, I pray tonight that everyone under the sound of my voice has witnessed that love and understand what he done for us we can never do for ourselves. God, we thank you. Let us have more wisdom about your word and understand it to the point that it breaks us down, Father. We realize that we cannot do anything on our own. It all comes from you. God, I just thank you now. Have your will and way as we sing this song of invitation, Father. Do what the Spirit needs to do. In Jesus' name, let's stand together. Temperature on the way to church, you know, Saturday it was in the 90s, and we got this lovely rain, and then it was in about 80s. You know, I think on the warmer side of heaven, it may be that, just kind of like right after a rain and that cool wind blows, how that feels. I think that's what heaven's going to feel like. Amen. But I do, don't forget, we got a short business meeting right after service is over with, so please stay and be a participant in that. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray tonight, and again, we thank you, Lord, for blessing us. God, we pray, Lord, for Sister Allison right now. God, she's on my heart. Lord, relieve that pain. Help them find out what's going on. Lord, if it be thy will, touch her and heal her. But God, tonight, we're going in to do the business for your kingdom. God, and I pray, Lord, you'd be right in the middle of it, and everything be as well as you'd have it to be. God, just give us the wisdom and be good stewards over that you've blessed us with. Father, as we go out this week, let us be the shining light we need to be to tell some lost soul. Maybe it just be one little plant that we may plant down right now. Help us, Father, to be that we need to be for them. And all God's people said, amen.